Yeah, AJ Mahar here. And I should just explain the wall over here. This is the chair scrapes on the wall. I'm not like, you know, beating the wall up or anything. I just thought, hey, it looks like maybe I got rough with the wall. No. That was many, many moons ago in my life. Anyway, that's just what you call wear and tear right there. Right there. Chair goes around that way. You know. Anyhow, I'm sure that's not what you come to this channel here about. And this is serious. In this video, following up on the video I just did again about going no contact with a cluster B personality disorder mother, I just wanted to follow up with a really gentle message, you know, about whether it's your mother or your father, like whether it's a parent that's cluster B personality disorder, and you're the child who's got an empowering parent, or a teen, or a young adult, or adult child, period. Or if it was your husband, or it was your wife, or your brother, or whomever, you know, that you loved and mattered in your life, and maybe still does matter in a way. But there's something that we all have to come to terms with sooner or later, hopefully. Some people don't ever in a lifetime. Because it's really, I don't want to make you afraid of it, or give you the impression to be afraid of it, but it's difficult and challenging. And what is that? Well, whether you're the adult child or teen child of the personality disorder person, the cluster B, whichever it is, PPD, MPD, comorbid BPD, MPD, sociopath, psychopath, or running the whole gamut like my father did when he was alive. You know, it is painful, and it is difficult, and it is, like, in a way, wrong, unjust, and so unfair to you. Whatever the situation, whichever type of relationship. But what you need more than anything, once you've given it all you've got, or, you know, in whichever type of relationship it is, I'm speaking from my own personal experience here now. It hurts a lot to go no contact, put up that boundary, and put yourself first. Especially for adult children who've never been put first by the cluster B parent. Especially if it's your mother. Just, you know, maybe she tried to do everything she could, but what she could do was just not that much emotionally, nurturingly, with nurture, with affection, with support, care, noticing you, seeing you, encouraging you, because maybe she's too busy being all about herself, she's a narcissist, or too busy just being lost because she's got BPD, not getting help, and doesn't know who she is or what to do. Low self-esteem, trying to overcompensate. It's a mess. But the one thing that we all share in common on the other side of cluster B personality disorder people, some people never do, okay, but they really live lives of misery and untold pain. And I think you know what I'm talking about if you're watching this video. So what you can, well, I shouldn't say hope for, but I guess what I would say, how would I say it? Well, I didn't know what was coming in my life years ago either, but I can say this much, that on the other side of really working through going no contact, once you realize the sort of like crazy Ferris wheel you're on, the whirlwind, the rabbit hole you're in, all these metaphors, because what's really happening is that you're being hurt, used, manipulated, blamed, criticized, devalued, maybe once in a blue moon idealized, but that's not real either. And what does it all really mean? It means that you aren't seen, that you represent, that they're projecting out themselves on you, in the case of parents often, but also partners, that they're seeing in you their wounding parent or perceived wounding parent, because it's, you know, 75% actual things happen and 25% perceived, which is just as real for the person perceiving it, you know, abandonment, for example. So they really feel abandoned, whether they were or not, as 75% of people who grew up with a cluster B mother in particular or parent. But spouses and exes and siblings that don't talk anymore, they all feel the same way. Because, you know, it's all about two things on the other side of cluster B personalities or people that you might love and care about. Three things. Will they get help? Are they getting help? Are they trying to change? Are they in a cluster B? Do they have a cluster B personality disorder in which that's even possible? And if they do, and they're not doing anything about it, and you probably see their behavior getting worse and worse over time, then there's two realities there, okay? One is there's no reason to stay in contact because they're not doing anything about it. They're not going to change. You're going to keep experiencing what you've always experienced, and it's going to keep hurting. And it doesn't just hurt as much. It can even hurt more. The toll it takes on you when you get into recovery, when you make that choice. And how do you make the choice to go no contact? By being really honest with yourself, with something that none of us should ever have to do. Cluster B personality disorder people do not love. They do not know how to love. You may love them. I know I tried to love my parents. I needed them when I was a kid. They were around and everything, but they weren't emotionally there. They didn't care about my latest little accomplishment or a good mark in school or... When I was in like grade 1 or 2, let's go way back now, maybe it was grade 3, I fell on my way to school in the morning. And back then we used to have to wear these things called leotards. I don't even know if they're out there anymore. Don't picture me in leotards, please. I haven't worn a skirt, a dress, pantyhose. I'm not that type, no. But when I was a kid going to school, we had to wear, girls weren't allowed, because I'm old, girls weren't allowed to wear pants. Until I got to about grade 9. That was in the early 70s, around 1971 or something. I don't remember. Anyway, so I was wearing leotards and some kind of, my mother just dressed me in like these jumper thing. I don't know if they have them anymore, but sort of jumpers with blouses. Not really even skirts or dresses, just pretty sort of, they were fine looking and fine clothes, but just a little... blasé. Maybe she was reading the tea leaves of the future that I was going to not like, girly-girly stuff, per se, to wear. So anyway, because we're all different, you know. But my point is, I'm going to school, I'm a little kid, I'm like, I think it was grade 1, but whatever, it was 1 or 2, it was some little grade there, you know. And I fell. So that's probably goofing around, skipping, I don't know, because it wasn't a happy kid, so why would it be skipping? But anyway, I fell, and I really smashed my knee pretty hard, I think on a rock, and then the sidewalk, or the side of the sidewalk. And so I cut my knee open pretty good, and sort of ripped the the leotard, and they were red leotards. See how much we can remember when things just don't go well at all, and we really hurt, and... I really knew that I just wasn't loved. And it took a long time to be able to go there. And so I fall and my knee is bleeding and I go to school. And I go home for lunch. And my mother was there at that time. But when I got a bit older, she would be working and, you know, I'd have lunch at home alone. Or if the golden child came and went at the same time. Because we were always in different schools because he failed so many darn many grades. Golden child. Failure, 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 failure to this day. Go figure. Whatever. Doesn't make any sense, right? So, and I didn't fail a grade in my life. So there you go. But whatever. So I go home for lunch, go back to school, And I'm kind of starting to think about the leotard that stuck to my knee where it bled, right? It stuck really, really. It's going to hurt. And so I went, and then in the afternoon, I'm realizing I got to go home. This could be the time that, you know, so anyway, I don't want to go on about this for the whole video, but so basically, yeah, I wasn't in the door long, and my mother all of a sudden notices, or she noticed before and didn't do anything about it, right? I mean, I don't know. I was just a little kid. But she's like, come here. And I'm like, no. And we go through that struggle for 10 or 20 minutes. And then she finally comes up to my room, and she just comes at me like some kind of a tiger, grabs the leotard and rips it off, you know, where it was attached to where I had clotted and developed a scab. And it hurt a lot, you know, but that in comparison to the pain of the day that I realized I had never been loved, you know, but even that was not a loving act, you know. There are ways to get stuck leotard or other kinds of material off of a kid's cut up knee. You know, you can dampen it, you can, there's all kinds of things you can do, but not her, just rip. And, you know, I was crying and everything. And then she got mad because I was crying. You know, it was just a series of emotional impossibilities and very wounding and damaging to me in my young life. And it took a fair bit of therapy, you know, so to get through it. Over it later, you know, when I was older, in my sort of like 20s, late 20s, early 30s. And then, so the point is, that wasn't the moment that I realized I wasn't loved. It was just one of those times when it occurred to me, like, what the hell was that? That doesn't seem very caring or very, I don't think I actually thought that exactly. But what we have to do, and yeah, you're strong enough. If I'm strong enough to have done it, you're strong enough to do it too. It just doesn't feel like it at the time. We have to look at that parent or that spouse or that sibling or whoever it is and realize that we have to put ourselves first and that they don't know how to love. And I've seen people posting on here with BPD who swear, and if you've had some treatment, that could be different. But people with borderline personality disorder, never mind NPD or beyond, they absolutely don't love. People with BPD who get some treatment, have some insight in between when they're acting, you know, in their devaluation cycles and emotional dysregulation, could they feel some kind of love or empathy, or I don't know about healthy love, but empathy? They have a lot of feelings sometimes, and they do feel for other people, but it's not consistent. And so if you look at what the definition of healthy love really is, and there are many of them out there, none of them really include on again, off again, on again, off again. So that's the real point under which I say it's time to set yourself free if you haven't already. Yeah, walk into that pain. Admit to yourself that that cluster B personality disorder person in your life or who was in your life didn't love you. And if that was your mother, I totally understand. I've been through that pain. It was my mother and my father and half my relatives, and now it's my whole family of origin. But it's been so long, it's like irrelevant now. And that's the good news I wanted to share with you. It is painful. It is awful in the beginning. But the only thing that's more painful or perhaps more terrible a way to live is to continue to try to please the unpleasable person, is to continue to try to be loved by the empty person, is to continue to try to give to somebody with no empathy, is to try to give to somebody who doesn't give to you, to try to love somebody who just wants to knock you down and criticize you, get supply from you, and in the case of narcissists, derives a lot of sadistic pleasure when they hurt you over and over and over. So it hurts to admit that you weren't loved, but let me share something with you. Neither was I, and it's not because of anything I did wrong, and it's not because of you either.